Thank you very much. It's a delight to be back at Dawson, and I am a jazz singer and songwriter, and I'm also a physicist. And so today I thought I would talk to you about the connecting the dots between astronomy and music. And the title of my talk is Songs from Outer Space. And the genesis for this idea and this project that I recorded a while back was when I was invited onto CBC Radio's The Sunday Edition to talk about International Year of Astronomy. And I performed a song on that program called Kiss Me Like That. And we had such great feedback from listeners across Canada that they wanted to know where they could get this song, and it prompted the idea to put together a project of songs, a collection of songs that I had written or covers of selected jazz songs that celebrate humanity's fascination for the sky and the stars. And so the first song that we're going to do for you is a song that I wrote in February of 2008 after witnessing the lunar eclipse of February 2008. And lunar eclipses take a lot longer to happen than a solar eclipse, which is over minutes. A lunar eclipse happens over several hours, and you have to be patient. And of course, it was February, and it was late at night, and there were about 3 feet of snow on the ground in Guelph, Ontario, where I was living at the time. And so this song is about the process of watching the moon turn this beautiful reddish glow as the shadow of the Earth passes over the surface of the moon.
Introduce the musician.
musicians. You're listening to Adrian Cho on the bass. Mike Rudd on the guitar. So we go from talking about nearby celestial objects like the sun and the moon that have fascinated mankind since time immemorial to looking a little further beyond the nearest portions of outer space. And another thing that has fascinated humankind, which is wondering if we're alone in the universe and thinking about the search for life on other planets and the search for perhaps extraterrestrial intelligence or SETI. This next song that I'd like to do for you is one that I wrote, which was partially inspired by some time I spent as an undergraduate researcher. Before I did my PhD, I had the great pleasure of working at the James Clerk Maxwell Radio Telescope. And one of the things that I found so fascinating about radio astronomy is that it shows us parts of the universe that we wouldn't ordinarily see through a visible light telescope. So over here, this image kind of illustrates why radio astronomy is so powerful. On your left, you have a visible light image from an optical telescope of a group of galaxies called M81. And as you can see on the left, you can't really tell whether those galaxies are interacting with each other, if they're even close to each other. Maybe one is closer to us and the others are farther away. But if you look on the right, this is a radio image of the same group of galaxies, and now you can clearly see that they're interacting very strongly with each other. They're exchanging gas and mass particles, and they're undergoing very strong gravitational interactions. This map has been produced at a well-known radio wavelength called the hydrogen line, and it has a wavelength of 21 centimeters. And the hydrogen line is a transition that occurs whenever the electron that's orbiting a proton in neutral hydrogen undergoes a spin flip. And when it flips its spin, it either absorbs or emits a photon at a wavelength of 21 centimeters. And so astronomers have hypothesized that perhaps an intelligent species out there on a different planet somewhere in the galaxy would choose the radio frequency range to communicate, because radio waves transmit quite well over long distances. But you wouldn't want to transmit at exactly the wavelength of hydrogen's transition, because otherwise there's a chance your information would be absorbed. So other astronomers have hypothesized that an intelligent species might use some multiple of the hydrogen line, and perhaps multiplying it by the number pi that would indicate their own mathematical sophistication. So when I was thinking about this song, I was also inspired by a book by Carl Sagan called Contact, which talks about a woman astronomer who's dedicated to the SETI, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, and she's also very evidence-based. She doesn't want to be told what to believe by others. She wants to see and discover everything for herself with her own eyes. The song Love in Outer Space that we're going to do an excerpt from shortly is also inspired not just by our attempts to listen for ET, but also to communicate with ET. So humankind has sent out probes in the past carrying messages for whoever might find the probes, like the Pioneer probes. And there was also a message sent out in the 1970s from the Arecibo telescope, which is pictured here. And as you can see, it's a dish that is actually carved out of the side of a mountain. It's the world's largest single radio telescope dish. And the message that was sent out in 1974 is pictured on the right-hand side here. And right above the representation of the telescope in purple at the bottom, you can see in yellow a representation of the solar system. So on the left is the sun, the big square with nine yellow dots. And third from the sun, they've offset the planet Earth to indicate that that's where the humans live, which is the stick figure in red right above there. And so this is a bit of a longer song, so we're just going to play a short excerpt of this. This is called Love in Outer Space. I tune my dial to the hydrogen line times pi, 'cause it's irrational just like me. Will you meet me on the same frequency? That you've come down from the mountaintop with all the answers on two slabs of stone. Your about just talking to the wind. There's no one likes to feel alone. So meet me on the international channel of love. Meet me on the international channel of love. I sent a call on a telescope carved from stone. It had a map of my neighborhood. We're just three rocks from the big ball of fire. Don't tell me that you never met a girl like me who didn't flutter at your slightest smile. You don't have to turn water to wine. A little kindness will do fine. So meet me on the international channel of love. That collects all these songs together, and it's called Kiss Me Like That. And this is a song that I wrote back when I was teaching undergraduate astrophysics at the University of Guelph. And there is a mnemonic device that we teach astronomy students to try to help them remember the classification of stars. Because stars, as you can see in this Hubble Space Telescope image, come in all colors. And there's a correlation between the color of a star and its surface temperature. So in this image, we've got some young, hot, blue stars. Blue stars are the hottest of the stars, and they can have surface temperatures of 30,000 degrees. And at the other end of the color spectrum, you have the red stars, which are very dim and very cool at their surface, only 3,000 degrees, more or less. And in order to classify the stars, we use letters, but there's not much logic to the letters that were devised to classify stars. So O and B stars are the hot blue ones. M class stars are the cooler ones. On this next diagram, you see what's called a Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, and it groups together the stars. And this big thing that looks kind of like a river across the diagonal in the middle, that's called the main sequence. All those stars are fusing hydrogen to helium in their cores. And on the top left, you see the blue O and B type stars. A, F, G are in the middle, and they're more yellow-orange. Our sun is a G type star, actually. And the K and M stars are red, and they're very cool. And most recently, astronomers in the 1990s discovered brown dwarfs. And they're not real stars, actually. They're kind of fail stars, because they don't sustain fusion of hydrogen to helium in their cores. But I had to add something to the mnemonic that I was trying to teach my students. And so I added like that. So the mnemonic became, oh, be a fine girl, kiss me like that. And this song started life as a sort of an aide-mémoire for students to remember that stellar classification system. And in fact, as I started writing the song, I realized it was turning into something a little bit angsty, a little bit of a metaphor for a relationship. Because I think the Big Bang is actually a great metaphor for a relationship that starts out hot and passionate and sort of cools down over time. So we're going to do this, we're going to end with Kiss Me Like That.
Kiss me like that. You begged me, my fire girl. remnants of